I'm Katie.
I'm Anna.
She's a psychotherapist.
And she runs a photography empire. Together we make music and we podcast
to encourage ourselves
and you
to do the things that scare us most. Hey everyone, welcome to season two. We could not be more excited to be back here with you creating new episodes. This season, we're focusing even more on bringing you interviews with people who inspire us. Today's guests have been a huge inspiration to me personally. The first time I saw Jill and Kate perform, I was at a writer's retreat trying to figure out if I was going to allow myself to actually tell people I was writing a book and that I wrote music. And here were these two beautiful girls on stage doing what I had always wanted to do. And I think that was the first time I allowed myself to say, if they can do it, I can do it too. And if they can try it, I can try it too. Which you may have noticed is what we're all about here at Doing Scary Things. So I'm curious, do you have a story of a time like this when you saw somebody doing something and decided to borrow some of their courage and try it too? If so, we want to hear from you. Join our Facebook group or comment on Instagram, but we want to hear your story. But for now, get ready for lots of inspiration and lots of laughs with Jill and Kate.
We're just so excited to be here with you guys today. So can you tell us who you are and what you've got going on?
Yeah.
Yes.
We're Jill and Kate.
Jill and Kate.
We talk the same time, yeah. So this is going to be really fun, right?
We're just super fun. Yeah, there are two people, but one voice.
Four of us in the room. I'm Jill.
I'm Kate. And together, we're Jill and Kate.
Wow.
We write songs. We have a podcast. What else do we do?
We perform.
Do a variety of things, yeah. But we're here in Nashville, Tennessee at the moment. We've been here for the last 10-ish years. We started singing together in college.
When we were five in 2003.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah. That's right.
Same.
Yeah. I was trying not to date us.
That's some good math.
Right? Yeah.
Thank you.
Fast math. Really,
yeah.
Yeah.
That's a lot. So, yeah. And we've been singing together ever since.
That's awesome. I did want to note, this is our very first interview with four people, right?
Yeah. Quad.
We've never
had. Yeah, yeah.
Our first quad.
And I feel like it's your first quad, but also we're like so alike. Like yes. We all do music. We both have a podcast. Like
yes, we're all blonde.
You and I have the same
name. Yeah. And like two are wearing red, two are wearing black-ish. It's like we really color coordinated. Our photo afterwards is going to be really great.
It really is.
Also because we have a professional photographer, so I'm counting on you.
Who's great at selfies, which is not true.
I actually have freakishly long arms.
Oh, good. Okay, yeah. Good.
So I got this down.
You got it covered.
Yeah. Anyway, awesome.
We all have our gifts.
You know? We do.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
I love it. Well, you said you do a lot of things, but one thing you did recently was a TED Talk.
We did.
What was that
like?
That
was terrifying.
When we got the call to do it, we were like, yes. Oh, my gosh. Like, honor of all. We were so just excited and thrilled at the idea. And then it was like,
we sat down to write it.
Yeah. And we're like,
our faces just went like blank. It was like, oh my gosh, what do you do for 14 minutes? I think it was under 16.
It had to be under 16 and you couldn't have any note cards and no teleprompter. So we had to memorize the whole thing. And there are two of us.
And
so
time
like,
it.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was fun. It was fun. Once we got done, we went to In-N-Out.
And then we drove like in crazy traffic because it was out in the LA area. Crazy traffic, 2 hours to get to our favorite sushi spot. Yeah. And I had one glass of wine and it felt like I'd taken a tranquilizer. Like I was so out of it. I was like, I think every ounce of like adrenaline and stress had like slowly just seeped out of my body and it was only the one glass of wine. And it was super intense. But it was really, it was such an honor to be able to do it. And then it did put our like speaking skills to the test because we have been getting into speaking more, which it's been great.
Yeah.
Because we can have our note cards and we can have like a set list and like we kind of will play songs.
We can mess up because it's not going to live on the internet forever probably.
And with the pressure of like it's a TED Talk.
Yeah.
Like did it change your life or not? Like that's a lot of pressure.
Right. That is.
But it was fun though. It was scary.
We had a funny, the day before I was going to tell them about what happened during the run through.
Oh.
They asked us to like come sound check because we were playing songs and speaking. And so we're in the middle of the thing, like our run through. And there's no one in this 1,500. There's 1,500 people there the next day. Not a person except for the sound people. So it was like an empty thing. I shouldn't have been nervous. I was more nervous at the sound check run through. We're going through it. And, like, I know what, like, Jill's last word is that makes me start talking and vice versa. I mean, we have, like, run this and rehearsed it. Like, for the week before, almost solidly, like...
We would drive around and just do it. Like
we would drive, like, getting ready in the morning. Like, anything that we were doing, it was, like,
we knew
rehearsing. Yeah. So I'm in the middle of my part, and they had screens on the floor that was facing up just with the time ticking down, which was
super
cool.
Oh, my gosh. That's so intimidating.
In your face. Like. In your face, just, like, flashing up at you, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, it's Mario Lopez's face.
On,
like,
the screen.
On the screen, doing, like, and I'm, like...
Doing, like, Entertainment Tonight or whatever he does.
And I just stop. I stop talking, and I'm like, Mario Lopez. And then I was like...
You said that out loud.
I said it out loud.
Perfect.
And then I was like, oh my gosh, what if this happens tomorrow? I would have to incorporate Mario Lopez into our talk.
I've spoken his name.
Yeah, I would have to be like, and Mario Lopez has shown us how he stepped out into the unknown and not... known what's ahead from him. It was really...
I mean, he seems great.
He seems great. I would have loved
AC Slater.
Yeah, I mean, come on.
Probably good in an improv situation.
Oh my gosh. You know? But I was like, what if that would have... And it totally... I mean, not only did, like, I lose my place, but then that, like, it was kind of like a little bit of a disaster. I mean,
they always say, you know, like, if you do bad at the sound check,
you'll have a good
job. Yeah. And so...
Oh, noted.
Yeah. So we were, like, happy that it didn't go that great.
Because
the next one went fine.
And then the day of, like, our slot was, like, 1 o'clock, and it kept getting pushed back. And I don't really get nervous. Like, to do a regular show, I, like, just feed off of people so much that I'm, like, so excited. I understood for the first time what people mean when they say, like, I felt like I was going to throw up before I walked down on stage.
Yeah.
Like, I really was like, oh, my gosh. Like, even Jill looked at me, and she was like, oh, no.
Because I'm, like, the shyer one of the group, so I count on Kate to, like, fill the space when it's, like, if something's going awry. Like, don't let me do it, because I will say ridiculous things or, like, make joke that
like doesn't... Like Mario Lopez.
Yeah. And Kate turned into me all of a sudden. She's, like, nervous, and I'm like, oh, no.
And I think what helped is that, like, I was nervous, like, 12:30 to 1, and then we, like, walked to, like, the green room side stage, because we hadn't been, like, watching anybody else's, because that was also really intimidating.
Yeah.
Watching everyone else, like, nail
some
it.
Some guy was, like, a prisoner of war, and I'm like, okay, that, like, trumps us, really. Like, like, how do you go after that, you know?
Yeah. But I think I had worked up all of my, like, vomitous feelings at 1 o'clock, and then they were like, oh, we're, like, 3 people behind. So I think everything
like,
Yeah. Nice. So I just sat in the back. I was like, oh, well, I can't practice anymore. I'm just, and then we did it. And it was the best feeling when it was over.
Yes.
It was great. Everybody should do it.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my congratulations.
That was a really long answer.
Seriously. No, I loved it.
Yeah.
From the call to like the day, how long was that?
It was not very long.
I think it was like a month, 3 weeks. It was like, no, we got the call beginning of January.
Yeah. Like January 2nd or 3rd. And what date? We did it February
3rd or 4th,
yeah.
Oh something. My gosh.
So it was like...
Which we also learned that people... We Googled like how to prep for your TED Talk, and it was like 9 months in advance.
Oh, like, check.
Oh my gosh! We're going to die.
Yeah.
We're
going to
die.
This is what kind of happens to us. Like, people ask us to do something, and we don't know how to do it, and we're like, yeah, that's a great opportunity. And then we just, like, figure it out, like, really fast. But, like... That doesn't always mean it's, like, the best thing, but that's, like, what you do. You just have to, if you get a good opportunity, it's, like, yeah, cool, I'll try it, you know?
Yeah, and
so
somebody
that's
reached
what we
out
did.
To us recently about a different TEDx talk, and I was, like, very hesitant. I was, like, oh, yes, we've already done one. Let
Someone
me know
did?
What you're thinking. Yeah.
I missed that one.
What was I saying about our email communication earlier?
Yeah, yeah.
Remember they messaged us on Facebook? And I was like, don't message us on Facebook. I mean, we do read them, but they get lost.
Yeah.
So always email us.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Even though we're not great at emailing. It's a way better chance than Facebook message.
We were both communications majors, and our communication is a little bit lacking.
That's awesome.
Anyway,
no,
sorry.
It's a lot. I feel like even for communications majors, giving like a delivered speech that's completely memorized, you know, but feels completely like organic and natural
is such a lost art. Yeah. Who but TED Talk would ask you to ever do that without note cards or anything?
It is, like, that's something, too, that I'm like, man, if we would have been doing this, like, speech 50 times beforehand, but there's no opportunity. It's like, who would like a 14-minute and a half talk from the two of us about this? It's like, there's not...
It gives you a place to do something.
Yeah, like there's that. Not, like, a platform. Sure, we've gone and spoken for, like, 30 minutes or 60 minutes, you know, like, but... 14 and a half minutes.
Would you guys deliver that 14 and a half speech to us?
I actually do still know it. Probably like 6 months later, I was like, Jill, do you think you can still do it? At one point, we were like saying each other's parts.
I don't even remember how it starts.
That's hilarious.
I don't either.
That, you have to like kind of put it out of your
mind.
We
should totally link to it.
Right.
Yeah, that's totally. Awesome.
So cool. So has a lot changed since then that maybe you wouldn't have expected or not really?
You mean as far as, like, did the TED Talk do any, like, bumps?
Yeah, for us? Like, or just, yeah, did it change your motivations at all, or?
Yeah, it did change our motivations. It was, like, a chance to really dig in and be like, what do we want to say, right? So we have songs and we say what we want to say in those songs, but this was, like, a real chance to be like, what do you want to say, like, to the world?
Yeah.
And I think that made us go, we need to be, like, saying more to the world. Not that, you know, everyone's going to listen. But so we decided we've always wanted to write a book. So I think the TED Talk kind of spurred us on to, like, starting the book.
You're right. It really focused us on, like, what we want to say in a, like, concise way. Like, we're saying things all the time.
But when you're artists or communicators, like, you do need a purpose behind it. It's not just, like, bleh, you know?
Yeah.
You have to say something meaningful, I think. So. Yeah. I think it's changed us in that way. Like, okay, what are we going to say now? You know? So, yeah. It's not like all of a sudden we got, you know, speaking gigs all over the world. It was more like internal.
Us and Oprah are hanging out just because of our TED Talk.
Super Soul Sundays next week.
Exactly. Yeah. We can have note cards. It's fine. I'm not worried about it.
No, but
I think, too, like, it we were right. It's such a unique point in our lives, too. We had just... It was the October beforehand that we had, like, sold everything, started our walkabout, left Nashville, started our podcast.
That's how it started. 123 days ago, I sold everything I owned. That was the first one.
Oh, that's a good start.
That's how it started. And I think that it was a unique time where it really felt like what we were talking about, because we were talking about going into uncharted waters. Like, you are not meant to stay at the shore. Like, all of that stuff. And it was a chance for us to, we did not have homes at that time. Like, we flew from I don't know where, like, afterwards. Like, I remember the hotel that we stayed at because it was the Four Seasons in Westlake Village.
That was nice.
Which we did not pay for. They put us up there, and it was, like, heaven. We just didn't get to enjoy it as long as we wanted to. But, like, all of the things that we had were with us. Like, we took everything. And so I think it solidified, like, talking about, like, what message we want to put into the world. It was this really unique time where we were literally saying and doing, like, the exact same thing. We were saying, like, go. Like, when it doesn't
take a
seem...
risk.
Yeah, when it doesn't seem logical, like, who sells all of their belongings? You know, just everything about it seemed, why would you leave Nashville? Like, you girls want to do music. Like, did you quit music? Like, you're leaving? Like, all of these questions that really... we thought people were going to ask us a lot more than people actually asked us. So I think it's that, like, assumed fear of, like, what are people going to think when nobody's actually thinking about you anyway?
Yeah.
But I think, you know, like,
thinking about themselves.
Everybody's thinking about just their own journey. I mean, a few people, we got a few questions, but mostly it was, like, from fans. Like, wait, you're leaving Nashville. And it was like, we're temporarily taking a spin out of Nashville. And so...
and don't know where we'll end up, but, like, that's... part of the fun.
You know? And that was, like, part of our message in the TED Talk, and that's what we want to put in this book, or what we've put in this book, is just, you might, like, for us, life was not going the way we thought it would. So you can kind of sit back and let it happen to you, or you can realize that you actually have the power inside yourself to, like, make the changes that you want. I think you girls are both such an example of that with your stories, and so yeah, that's kind of what the TED Talk made us. It was a cool, like, life moment. It was a life marker, for sure, that was terrifying.
And I think that's, super cool. Like, it was a window into you know, like you're saying, what's meaningful that we want to say to the world? And, you know, that was a window into yourself to see like, oh, this is in there, you know?
Yeah.
That's so cool. I love that.
Yeah. I love that you did the TED Talk while on the walkabout.
Yeah, it was like kind of, you look back at stuff like that and you're like, oh, that was perfect timing, because we were able to give the message that we were living in that moment.
And that's something that we also have learned and are still learning, how much like motion begets motion, mm-hmm. and how you need to move if you want to see things change. Like, there's no stagnant growth. There's just not. Like, and for us, leaving Nashville for our walkabout was like the little push that we needed to get unstuck. It was like, what can we do? You know, we had so many almosts and maybes happen in this town. Mm. And so many things that like, oh, this might work out, and it didn't. And it's like, oh, this thing could be so cool, and it didn't. Like, all of these different things. And yet, now I think, oh my gosh, if any one of those things would have worked out, we probably wouldn't have done the walkabout. And then I'm like, then we probably wouldn't have given a TED Talk, and all of these other things. But you realize how once we made that decision to sell everything, to do the walkabout, it's crazy how, like, it felt like the train started rolling, and all of a sudden it just, like, everything picks up speed. And I'm not preaching against, like, rest and, like, all of those.
Sure.
Those are all good things I, like, enjoy. I think it's really, you need to rest. But I'm saying, if you're feeling super stuck.
Right.
There's got to be, even if you're feeling stuck, like Allison Fallon said on your guys' podcast, like, write. Like, do something. That's motion. Even if your fingers right. are typing or you're writing, like, do something.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a big difference between rest and stuck.
Yes.
You know?
Totally.
That's like, yeah, not for nothing either.
Yeah.
Like, wow, that's a whole thing I need to
think
about.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I like how you casually glazed over, like, so we, how you sold everything and took some time off. So for people who may not know that part of the story, can you just elaborate a little bit on that?
I just think I'm best friends with everyone. Like, you know, the walkabout.
Yeah, a walkabout is, if you want to set that one up, it's an Australian term where it's sort of a time of it's like wanderlust, I guess, is like.
But it's kind of wandering on purpose.
On purpose, yeah. So we.
And we didn't come up with that. A friend. We told our friends this plan.
It's a word, but we don't. People, like someone was saying, in the States, we don't really have a word for that. People sometimes mm-hmm. say, like, a gap year or like
a sabbatical.
Yeah.
Because people don't do it in the States.
People don't do it.
And it's like graduate from high school or right to college.
Yeah. And get married and then do again. It's like there's so many steps. And when those steps, there's nothing wrong with that. Mm-hmm. That's like, if that happens, great. Like that's your journey.
Yeah.
If those things don't happen, you might have an opportunity to be like, what else does life offer for mm-hmm. me? And that's, I think, where we were at. It was like, we both weren't married yet. We're still not married. And like, work stuff was kind of it was just not, why do I keep doing that sound? I don't know.
it's a great sound.
Thank you.
I'm here for it.
Work stuff wasn't great. Personal, it was just like a funk, you know, when you're mm-hmm. just in a funk. So we just, one day I looked around my house and I owned a house, which was great. But it was like, I couldn't even enjoy it because I felt so just stuck. could you name the podcast that?
Just the
blah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Totally. I'm just kidding.
So, got a lot to say. Blah. I'll work on the phonetics. Yeah. Think about it.
So I looked around my house. Kate was gone. She was in Colorado. And there were like 16 chairs that people could sit in my house. You know, like couches and dining room and all this stuff. And that like hit me so hard. I was like, why do I have there's no one here. It's me. Mm-hmm. And I have 16 chairs and like, I'm just sitting in this because I'm in such a funk and like my life isn't going the way I planned it. So I was like, I just don't think I want this house. I think I want to like be free from everything and see what happens. So I called Kate because we're kind of on this journey together. You know, we're like, we were in the middle of, I don't know, I don't know what we were working on at that time, but
nothing really.
We were kind of stuck. Yeah. So I was like, hey,
really sad song.
Yeah. Oh, that's true.
Actually, we love sad songs.
I know. I heard you guys say that. So we just like, yeah, I just was like, called her and I was like, hey, I think I want to sell the house and like everything.
Also, I was living it.
Casual. She was living. Yeah. And I was like, I think I want to just like travel for a while and like see what else is out there, because like I can't do this. And she's like, yeah, cool, let's do that.
That's awesome.
I'm 7. Yeah, she's down. You know, you get to a point and you're just like, I think we were both there. Someone had to say it, like something needs to change here. So I said it, but like Kate was like, yep. So
she's ready to receive it.
Yeah. And everything just worked out. I mean, I put my house on the market. 10 days later, someone put an offer in. I got multiple offers. And then I was like, hey, I'd love to sell it furnished. But if you don't, I mean,
yeah,
when who buys a house furnished? Sure. They were like, yeah, we want to buy all the furniture in the house. So I didn't have to go through that whole process. Like it was like a 3-bedroom, I mean, fully furnished. And so they bought that on top of
just like little picture, like they stuff wanted that wasn't everything. Personal. Like they were just like, no, we want it all.
We want it just like this. I know. Well, that's the thing. It's like, it just was like a God thing, or like whatever happened was meant to be.
And you know, I got home like 2 days later. And we like talked about it face to face for the first time of like, oh, is this really what we're really gonna do this? And I was like, yep. The next day, our friend who's a producer, texted us and he was like, hey, and we'd been wanting to work together for a long time, but like our schedules never aligned. And he was just like, I want to work on something that I really believe in. I have all of August free. What are you guys doing? And what was crazy was that like we knew that we had like this time gap because Jill's house was not going to close we were going to have enough time. And it was like
the perfect,
we hadn't told anyone, like we'd only like voiced it to each other of like, I think we want to sell everything and get out of here. And then like this producer that we'd been wanting to work with, like, and that was in July. So it was like, wow, next month I have the whole month free. Like, let's record. And he was just like, no strings attached. Let's just like do it.
Yeah. I think you take one step into like the unknown, like the scary place. And a lot of times things just start happening and you have to take the first step. I think that's like the biggest part of it. And so that worked for us for that time. So that was cool. I'm not saying that you don't have to sell all your stuff.
Right. I know that was one of the funniest things. We documented the whole thing on our podcast and then we would get texts of like, I'm going to do that. Like I quit my job and I'm moving. And we're like, oh,
we didn't expect that.
Yeah, like, are you sure?
Yeah.
Have you thought this through?
Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know.
I love it.
Yeah.
Were a lot of people saying that to you guys? Like, we are got you that. Sure?
You know what? No. We didn't get that weird. A lot, which we expected.
Mm-hmm.
Our families or, like, friends. And everyone was like, yeah. I think
our manager, who we were like, oh, man, how are we going to tell her? She's going to be like, what do you mean? Like, this Nashville is like where you want to be if you're doing music. Like, why? And she was like, absolutely, go for it. She was like, you guys need to like because that's what we kept saying is like, it feels like we're running on empty.
Yeah.
You cannot be creative. Mm-hmm. You can be depressed and write songs because you've got something in your tank. But right. Like, even once that depression, once everything is depleted from you, like there is no life to feed creativity. Even like heartbreak is life, so it feeds the creativity. And there was just a point where like we wrote a song called Nashville, and it was kind of like that song was written in April, and we talk about leaving. It talks about leaving.
Mm.
And when I was actually gone, Jill started writing it. I got home. Jill was like, can I play this song? And I was like, yeah, but I'm really hungry. I need some yogurt. So I got my
true. Very important just, part of the story.
Yeah. And I was like, okay. Because, I mean, this happens a lot. Like, we'll, like, play songs for each other. And so I'm like, yeah. Let me just get some. I remember it was yogurt because she started playing the song. And I had yogurt in my mouth. And started ugly crying. Like, and immediately I'm, like, grabbing my phone. I'm like, stop. Like, hitting. Because I was, like, so nervous that she hadn't recorded it or written it down or whatever.
I'm bad about that. Yes, I don't like
don't
hit record.
Forget it.
And Kate's such always a genius like, that I'm
putting
like,
record oh, God,
like, we're gonna lose
like,
it.
Did you record that? And I'm like, no, I forgot.
So you can hear me in like the original recording of that song. You can hear me like sobbing. Like that. And I had some yogurt down. Like it was a whole thing. So that's why
I can't eat yogurt anymore.
After seeing
it, it was a scene. But anyway, we wrote that song in April, and then when we started to play it for people, like our friend like JJ
about,
was like,
it's about leaving Nashville. Like, yeah, that's like, you know,
yeah. He was like, I mean, are you guys leaving? We're like, no,
of course
absolutely not. And we really, that was not like pretense or that was every fiber in our being. It was like, absolutely not. We just needed to write the song. It was very therapeutic, which was true.
I mean, and then, your art tells you more about yourself, you know, than you are writing.
Tells you tried that song about becoming millionaires? Yeah. Marrying the really hot guys? That's next. That's what
we're going to work on. I think we should, like, maybe co-write that with Ariana Grande. Yes. Can you hear it?
I
can
hear it. Great idea.
Anyway.
Oh, man.
Yeah. As long as there's yogurt involved.
Yeah. Right. Oh, gosh. I know. That's why I had to say that I could, it's not like I was eating some chips or something.
Right.
It was a yogurt.
That would have been like, in that recording.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Wow.
That was so funny. I was not expecting you to say the word yogurt. It just, like, tickled me to death when you said it.
I was like, wait.
Yeah.
Where is this going?
I also, I love food, so it's not shocking that, like, I remember exactly what I was eating. It's the story of my life, really. Like, I've always got snacks with me.
I love it.
Yeah. Amazing.
Oh, my gosh.
I am speechless. I love that song, but that's interesting that you guys wrote that before you even knew that you would be leaving. And and now you're back.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah. We're kind of, I'm back-ish. I'm here. Sure. I'm non-committal now. So I'm like, I'm still not sure, but I'm here for, like, work stuff is my hub. So that's good.
Well, I was wondering that, like, so the momentum train is going
right
now, you know, like you walked about and got unstuck and now you're, like, a lot more free to kind of move about the cabin, but, you know, what is it like for you now? And are there scary things on your horizon?
Oh my gosh.
You know, what's happening with that?
Yeah.
That's a good question.
That's a great question.
Thank you.
That's a really great question. Especially, like, I love that we've been talking about the walkabout so much. It was really, truly, I think, I don't want to say, like, the happiest time of my life. Because it wasn't even that. It just felt so intentional of, like, doing what we set out to do in a very unconventional way. But it really fueled, it put gas back in the tank. Like, it was life-giving in all of those things. And my friend, who had also done, like, a walkabout, he was like, you'll just know when it's time. Like, you'll just know. Mm. And that's something that I've been really working on is, like, trusting myself. That's, like, one of my affirmations that I'm trying to do, like, that I trust myself because I have a terrible habit of second guessing. And I would much rather just, like, somebody tell me what to do and I'll follow that and do it as best as I can. But to really listen to my own intuition, I'm like, what if I make a bad decision? Like, what if I can't... I don't like to make the wrong decision. Like, as much as I talk about how important failure is, like, I think that's the lesson that I keep having to learn.
Yeah.
Is, like, you're going to fail sometimes and that's okay.
Well, owning it's always hard.
Mm. Yeah.
You know?
It is. And so I was kind of feeling like I knew it was getting close. It was just, honestly, part of it was just physical of, like, carrying everything that you own in two suitcases and a backpack. And as a human, you just accumulate stuff. Like, we sold everything. And somehow, like, my trunk was, like, full all of a sudden. And I was like, how did this happen? And then I got rear-ended. And then I had to take everything out of my trunk. And it was like getting a Vitamix out of my trunk. And, like,
I did keep the Vitamix.
Yeah. Oh,
they were, like, goodness. Random things that you keep when you're selling everything.
You're like,
You're like, this corkscrew, I cannot part with this.
Very important.
All the things I kept. But it was just, like, one of those things that I was like, okay, physically I'm kind of getting, and emotionally I'm ready for, like, my people to be back in close proximity, because it was hard seeing my good friends every few months or something like that. And so decided back in Nashville, it was kind of, like, up in the air. I loved Denver. Like, I spent a portion of the beginning of the year there and I loved it, but I was like, it just doesn't quite feel right yet. So I decided on Nashville, like, found this place. And I think it was, like, our first podcast episode that we did when we were back here, when, like, you know, you just, like, remember one comment, somebody commented and was like, wait, you're back? Aren't you just going to get stuck again? Like, and they weren't doing it in, like, a negative way. They were like, are you just going to go right back to where you were?
I think we made this big statement of, like, we're leaving.
Sure.
And we wrote this song and it, like, did pretty well for us.
So bye.
It was like, yeah. So I think people were like, wow, this is, like, a statement and they're leaving. And, like, and so when we're here,
But we did, I will say, we never said that we were, like, leaving Nashville. We didn't,
but I'm saying in the song and everything, yeah. it felt like that.
It was a breakup song.
Yeah, it was a breakup song, exactly. Mm-hmm. But, like, I think people want to, like, I don't know, like, they weren't ready, maybe, for us to be done with the walkabout, well, which we're not really done with the walkabout.
And I think that's what I was going to say, though, of, like, what's scary on your horizon,
yeah.
then. I feel like that statement... Like, I had not even thought about that until I read that statement. And we try to be so involved in people commenting or asking us questions. We have a cell phone number that people can text us at any time. Like, yeah. we've texted with people when they're in labor. Like, oh it's, God. Like, a thing. So it feels like this little community. And when that person said that, I think it planted this, like, fear, yeah. the seed of fear of, like, oh, you're probably just going to go right back and get stuck. When that is not at all how I was feeling.
Yeah,
like, absolutely. I had such different feelings. I was like, no, the place that I got is, like, life-giving, and I love it, and it's, like, serving me in all of these ways. And I was like, I don't feel, like, I'm so happy to see my friends and my community. But I think that is, like, one of the scary things for me. I mean, you can answer yourself, but, like, the scary thing on the horizon is just feeling, like, oh no, is this momentum train gonna stop?
Right.
What does it look like now? And we've been writing this book, which for me, I'm such a people person. Like, this just delights me. Like, to talk to, like, it really does. Yet, writing a book is a lot of solitude and alone time and me with my thoughts. And, like, we can't, as much as we're writing it together, like, Jill has her words to get out on the page and I have mine. And so it has just been, like, there have been many a moment in the last, like, 3 months where I'm like, I have nothing to say. No one cares.
No
like,
words.
Yeah, like, this is ridiculous.
Well, we haven't been, like, playing shows that much, yeah. which is where we kind of, like, feed, you know,
tries.
Feed
us. Yeah.
So we're like, especially Kate, because I'm, like, more like, ooh, writing for a season. That's so nice. Like,
yeah. And she'll have to literally, how many times do you think you've reminded me?
Yeah.
Like, she literally has to go, like, when I'm having a meltdown, she'll be like, but remember, right now we're writing the book. And I'm like, oh, yeah, okay.
Oh, that's
that,
right.
Like, sets her back.
Yeah, to,
like,
context. Yeah.
Yeah, like, reminds me to not freak, because I freak out and I'm like, this must be over. Like, no one cares. Like, nothing, you know, which is so, it's unfounded, but it comes yeah. from my own. That's my scary
yeah.
thing.
It's scary to be on a journey that you don't know yeah. what's going to happen or where you're going to end up.
What's your scary thing?
That, on I mean, horizon. I mean that, but also, like, what's my scary thing? I think I'm really trying to learn how to be content with myself and, like, what season I'm in. And I think I'm just scared all the time of, like, life that's, like, scary. So this isn't a good answer. What am I scared of? I'm just scared of getting stuck again and, like, settling for
yeah.
a life that I could have a better one. I think that's yeah. it.
The idea that, you know, coming back to a place where you experienced stuckness before, mm-hmm. there's so many reminders potentially, right? And even, like, literally people reminding you about it, which is super helpful, by the way. But it just occurred to me, like, well, Nashville's the same, but you're different.
Yeah.
You know? That's huge.
So true.
Yeah. And, like, that can't go backwards.
Right.
You know?
And that was kind
that's
of...
That's huge.
And
that's
I wanted to say that, or, like, Jill was like, I just don't think you should address it. And I was like, I want to, because I'm like, one, if one person's thinking it, probably more people are thinking
yeah.
it. And I think it's so true. It's like, I think I'm not the same person that, like, drove out of here a year and a half ago. Like, so much has changed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it kind of feels like the baby in the bathwater idea. And I don't, it's like life is really challenging. Like, a lot of the time.
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. it's, so I feel.
If you're willing to engage with it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's there are a lot of challenges. And I feel like, not that part of me felt like I was, like, running from it if I started over somewhere else, but I was kind of glad to, like, there was so much good here that I was like, I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater.
Right.
Like, there was a lot of really negative things that happened here, but, like, I don't need,
yeah.
I can.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean it's all bad.
My counselor was like, you uprooted your garden
and you're carrying your garden around. And some plants didn't survive, and that's okay. Like, that's how she was talking about my relationship. I was like, I am a gardener.
Like, our counselors with their metaphor is just the best.
They are.
My favorite part of my job is all the metaphors.
Do they just come to you in the moment? You're just like,
a lot of times, yes.
Do you have a book of metaphors?
Yes, I write down after a session. Lot of songs.
Yeah, I write songs.
Right.
It was super. I'm such a visual person that the garden thing.
Yeah.
And she was like, and now you're probably looking at where to like replant.
Yeah.
Shout out to Beth.
Yes.
I love how calm her voice was.
Yes.
It's very soothing. Like that. She's like, so, isn't she?
Yeah. That sounds like she knows what's up.
I was thinking when you were telling that story of Jill reminding you, but this mm-hmm. is what we're working on.
Yes.
And I can relate to that so much. We did a podcast episode actually with my husband, and it's probably the most depressing episode we have. he has apologized. We kind of caught him on a day he was sick and not feeling good. But I feel like, you know, that's a conversation we have a lot of you know, wait, is this working out? Like, where are we going? And I think that's such an important message to be like, you know what? This is how we get there. This is step one. Mm-hmm. When we're done with that, then we move on, you know, and you can't do all the things at once, you know,
totally.
You can like look down the road and see where you want to be, but you can only do like one thing at a time.
Yeah.
That
is so true.
We can't do all the things at one time.
It was so true. I feel like it's funny how we forget so quickly, like when we're out of our comfort zone or something, or for me, when I'm not getting the like super interaction with people that I normally get when we're speaking or singing, that like to do something new and different, something I love to do, but like I like writing a blog like before I go to bed after a show or something, you know, like after I've had my people time. And so just, and even to like write and not have anyone see it, like it's not, there's I'm an impatient person.
There's a lot of our book that we're writing that I haven't read stuff Kate's written yet, and she hasn't for me. Yeah. So it's kind of like very solitude, even for us.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
like, oh, okay, like, you know.
It's just been a process. And so literally to have someone, I mean, I need it like on a sticky note on my hand.
I'm
so
always like, you're writing a book.
Yes.
You're writing a book.
It like, sounds so dumb.
Add it like to your affirmations.
I know.
And it's when it's
you
out
are in
what,
season of writing a book. Actually, but we have two more days of writing. Like, it will be done.
What?
I mean, like,
well, the first
draft. Yeah. But, like, getting
huge.
All the words on the page.
That's huge. Writing. Yeah.
You're writing a book.
I am. I relate. I just want to say I relate to everything you're saying.
Yeah. Yes.
So Anna has read it.
Yeah.
She's the only one.
Okay. Cool.
I haven't shared it with anybody else yet.
She even let me edit.
Ooh, she edited it. She's a great editor if you
love
need one.
Editing.
But I know that feeling a little bit of like, first of all, it's going to be so final, kind of like the TED Talk, right?
Yeah.
Like,
right.
That's what we came up with. We were like, we can't delete a book. Like, you can delete a blog, you can delete an Instagram post,
right.
Like a book is, that's big. And there is so much of that of like, am I going to feel this way in 5 years? Or like, is this going to come across the wrong way? You know, and I know that's like the people pleaser in me, but there's so much that I'm like, I have to get this right. And it just seems so hard.
It's
But, but I love that you guys almost have it down.
Yes.
And now when
and
will you, are you going to do like a big exchange? And
well,
like,
we're putting it all into one.
Yeah.
We don't know.
Yeah. No, we finally, like yesterday was the day that I like pulled from all of our docs and put it all into one. Cause we're trying to hit a word count.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so I was like, I think we're on track, but we've not done the like, let's put it all in one and count all the words, and we did, and it was like, oh my gosh, this is crazy. I can't believe we've written.
Yeah, so we're gonna have a day and like read through it together.
Yeah.
Before we do any editing or anything and just
super
see like
cool.
what we're missing. Or
we did a book
proposal
the day. So
coaching.
Allison Fallon.
Yeah, I was gonna ask if you were
we
with her.
Call her Allie.
Yeah.
So Allie. I can't say like Allison Fallon.
Yeah,
I was like, who's Allison?
Right. Allie. We did one of her days, like where she like does the whole
coaches
day with you.
Us.
Yeah, and so that was so helpful because otherwise it would have
yeah,
been a hot mess. But
I know I was so sad that I met her after, and I know I'm sure she could still help me. But
in your next book,
exactly, yeah. But I will say that I had to take a break. So I was part of a class in Atlanta that helped me get the words on the page, and then they recommended, I think, taking like 30 days off. I took a year and a half.
I love it.
Where I didn't really think too much about it, right? But everybody's like, "How's the book coming?" I'm like, "It's good. You know, it's great. Any day now, you know." But now I'm back to that season of actually trying to figure out, okay, does this make sense? Am I headed in the right direction? And so I see where you guys are going, and it's also challenging, but it's really exciting to like see it come together.
Yeah.
So that's exciting. Yeah.
I think it's a cool testament. It's a cool testament also just to community. Like when you're stressing out about it and you happen to be the person at that time that has the clarity. Let me remind you of this clarity.
Yeah.
And like, it's a testament to just the power of community. You know, that's one of those amazing benefits of like, even as scary as it is when you're in the middle of it, like you are, you're like in the process, but you shared it with me. Sometimes I can share some clarity with you.
Yeah.
You're working on this together, you know, like.
And that's like one of the main reasons that we write songs, that we write blogs, that we write. It's that power of like, oh, I feel that way too. Or like having that shared commonality of somebody providing clarity of like, I felt this way and now I feel this way. And somebody's like, how did you get there? Like, fill in that bridge for me.
Right.
I think that's the power. That's like why when somebody's like, I want to start a podcast, I'm like, do it. Because you probably have something to say that somebody needs to hear, or writing a book or writing a song. And I think it can be so intimidating thinking, oh, man, there's so many people already. I mean, even as I'm writing, I'm like, I don't know that. It just like all of those fear voices that come up in your head.
Definitely.
And it's just you're right. It's like such a reminder that community is so important, whether that's like actually your physical community, people online in a community.
It's connection with other people. Yeah. It's
super important.
Yes. So in our quad.
Yes.
I was talking to Katie about this earlier. Like, I'm so curious, you know, how your dynamic together works. I feel like you sort of demonstrated that a lot, even just, you know, in this talk here, but
talking over each other a lot.
Listen, it's an art form, right? I'm just curious, what's it like for you guys, and how do you negotiate the world together, you know?
That's a good question. We have a really unique friendship and like working relationship that I don't know exists a lot of places. Maybe it does.
Yeah.
So it's like we kind of work as like one unit a lot. I mean, and that's been good and bad.
And
you disagree?
No, I wouldn't. But I feel like adding some context to that, I think it's just we decided at a really early age, like when we, not early age, just early. I guess
when you
it
were
was
five.
Early. When you were five and we went to college. Yeah. In 2003, when we met, we were both five. We made
That's
this decision to like, it. I don't know how, because, you know, I see kids that are like that age, and I'm like, wow, we were that age when we said yes to this dream.
Yeah.
And like, we both super committed. Like, I guess we are also very loyal people.
Yeah.
But it's felt like, no, this is like what we are made to do, and we're not going to stop until like,
yeah,
there's some divine intervention, or that God tells us like, nope, you're done with that.
Yeah.
And there have been a lot of times when we've been like, do you want to stop? Like, it feels, and it's like, for whatever reason, this is like our life's calling. And I say our life's because it feels like our lives. And so I think that that's just some context for
how we work together.
Because it's not like, even though we're two separate people, like every decision that we make, it's like we bounce off of each other. You know, I can't just be like, hey, I'm going to peace out for 3 weeks. Like, because that leaves her being like, okay, so what about our podcast? And like, what's going on?
But we've can do that. It's just, we have to negotiate that together.
Yeah.
It's like,
that's what I was going to say. You know, we've gotten a lot better about
good, because we were like always together. always, people call me Kate. People, someone did today, and Kate wasn't there. You know what I mean? Like, that's happened.
All the time.
That happens to me, actually, a lot.
Yeah.
Someone called me Kate.
That actually happened last night for
me. Yeah, I mean, it's what happens. People, and that's fine, and we don't care.
Yeah, yeah.
But we got kind of like, oh my gosh, people think we're one person. We don't know who we are. Like, very deep counseling of, like, what are we doing?
Yeah.
Like, how do we become person... like, person Kate and person Jill without
well, especially after we were on the like road for yeah. so long. Yeah. Like, we had very little community. Like, our whole identity was, like,
Jill and Kate.
There's backup singers or Jill and Kate. And it was just, like, this... We were kind of, like... Where at literally, people would, like, call it, like, just at me. And they'd be, like, hey, Jill and Kate. And I'm, like, it's actually just half of that. But, okay. Like, yeah. whatever. So, I mean, and that's great. That's the other thing, is we realize... That's, like, so good for branding and business. Like, when somebody sees Jill that they think Kate, like, people pay so much money to, like, work on doing, developing their brand.
Yeah.
To try to, like, get there. So I feel like for branding and for business, it was great. But personally, it kind of was hard for us.
Yeah.
But we've gotten a lot better at, like, boundaries of, like, when we're,
yeah.
we try not to work all the time, like, around the clock of, like, you know, because we're not really living together. Like, I have my own place, and when Jill's in town, she stays with me. So it's like when she's in town, she's, but we have our own space. But literally, there are times where it'd be like 9:30 at night, and email would come in. It was like, okay, so should we blah, blah, blah. And we'd start, and that would generally lead to like tension or arguing because like you're tired.
You're
you
like,
should not be making decisions.
Yeah, it's yeah. not work time. Yeah.
So now we'll literally be like, can I ask you a work question if it's like
yeah.
late in the evening? And most of the time, it's like, no.
No.
Like, and we respect it.
Good it's to
like,
know, okay, yeah.
yeah. You know, it's hard because we're like friends and then we're running a business and we're like trying branding or, you know, or a brand or whatever. Mm-hmm. Not, I mean, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
So it's like you have
you can
to
call it a brand.
Okay. so we've had to learn how to like.
Yeah.
When are we friends and when are we like we don't really
we are enemies right now. I mean, this might look fun, but we
no. no when are we working
so
and
good.
When are we
friends? Right.
I know.
Oscar worthy.
We really don't we really get along well. That's like
yeah.
a gift.
Yeah.
I don't know how that happened, but
yeah.
How is it for you as a music duo? Like, do you find that you have a lot of really good chemistry that started really well together. Like, how did all that work? How
yeah.
did the music side of it come together?
I'm we curious. Were at a music school in college, had an assignment or a semester abroad type thing. We had to write a song with someone else, like a co-write.
Mm,
so we were
student.
Paired up or we chose to do it. I can't remember. And it just clicked like literally the first time we ever sang together. It was like, it just worked. It
You're
was
like, oh.
Yeah. And so we were like, cool. And we sang it in front of our peers and our professors. And everyone was like, you guys are like related somehow. Something's going on.
Yeah.
Like your siblings. And we kind of took that and like ran with it. And
yeah.
just, we really liked how it just, we never have had tension in music. It's
yeah.
always aligned. Like, I can never think of a time where the direction we were going, we like disagreed. So I think it's just like a musical soul spirit.
And we thing. Grew up in such different ways. Like, Jill lived on the same street her whole life. Like, you know, went to college like an hour away from her house. I had, by the time I was 9, had gone to school on 3 different continents. Like, had no consistency like whatsoever. But when we became friends musically, like, we loved the same things. We knew like weird parts in songs that like were background parts or stuff that like, that was my favorite part of the song. And she'd be like, me too. And it was like,
we hear
crazy...
the same
yeah.
music. It's super weird.
Well, because you hear it in your head first, right? You know, like, that's the magic, is getting what you hear in your head. I think for artists sketching,
yes.
it's like they see it in their mind and they got to get it out on paper.
Right.
It, you know, for musicians, it's like we can hear it in our heads
yeah.
and it's getting it out. And I think what was helpful right at the beginning is I think we were both a really safe space to like, Jill had been writing songs since she was like 11. Like, I had just in my like late teens, early 20s started like messing around a little bit with like, oh, can I write a song? Like, I don't know if this is even a song, like just that kind of a thing. And I feel like you were such a, like, gracious, you were just so kind and, like, coaching me, if you will. Like, and so it
so
never
kind.
Felt, I mean,
she's
because
like,
songwriting is so vulnerable. You
yeah.
have to be like,
yeah.
this might be a terrible
100%.
Idea. Like, oh my gosh, does this even make sense?
Cool.
Yeah.
yeah.
Like, this is about someone else, I promise. Like, it's not about my life. Like,
yeah, and I think we did. We built trust with each other right away, because when you write a song with someone, you do that. Like that. So that was the first really thing we ever did together.
Yeah.
Is write a song and sing it. And I think that like was the basis of like the trust and the.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So super cool.
And I think having similar music tastes is also, I mean, there's, it's not like it's exactly the same, but foundationally, I think we both really just enjoy the same type of music. So it makes it easy to like make music that we
that,
both are kind
that
of.
That naturally like fits one the other. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
Who and are some of your favorites? Sorry, I didn't mean to.
No, no, no.
Who are some of your favorites?
Currently, I'm just like an Ed Sheeran girl and Shawn Mendes.
Nice.
But like
so catchy.
More so like catchy. Previously like John Mayer, Alanis Morissette. We both loved Amy Grant.
Yeah. Patty Griffin is like our favorite.
Patty Griffin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome. Which we met her last year. And it's like a thing. It was at an airport and Jill, we'd just seen her play the night before.
Oh my god.
And
gosh.
There we are in the Denver airport. Jill's on the phone. And she's like elbowing me, and I was like, what? Like, stop. And she's like trying to say something because she's on the phone, and I was like, what? I like did not get it, no clue. And sitting right across from us was Patty Griffin. And so finally she was like, can you hold on? She was like, it's Patty Griffin. And I immediately start to cry. Like, literally, I started to cry.
Were you eating yogurt?
No.
Okay. Just so
luckily,
you can sure.
I was dying. And Jill like hangs up and immediately starts filming me, which is so kind. That's and I'm like,
oh my gosh.
And awesome. I was like, we're going to say hi to her.
I was
going to
say, please tell me.
And Jill's like, no, we're not. Because really, truly,
we don't
have
do
I
that.
Ever, I don't think in the however many years we've been working
Ed Sheeran
together,
was lying on a airport floor at the gate. Like, we had just played a gig. Yeah. And he was maybe hungover. And I didn't, he's like my favorite. And I didn't go.
You didn't like accidentally trip over him or anything?
No, I should have. But like, we just don't. Go talk to people. It's just
it's
like
it's just not. But I was like,
Kate was.
This
like,
is our favorite songwriter of all time. She's not like our age. She's a little bit older than us. So I was like, you never know. I was like, if this is the woman that has written like my favorite song of all time, I'm gonna tell her.
Yeah.
And I was like, and you're coming with. Also because like we had covered one of her songs. Like there was some like. Not we, but, like, Kelly, who we were singing with, like, the three of us sang, like, her song at our final show. I was like, there's some history there.
Exactly.
She was so nice. It was a good moment. I probably talked the fastest I've ever talked in my whole life. I think I was like, I was at your show last night. It was really good, blah, 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 blah. And then it was, like, 26 seconds later, and we were walking
then she
away.
Was on our flight.
Yeah.
She was on our Southwest flight to Nashville.
Yeah. Yes. And I was like, if it goes down, I'm like... The world is losing Patty Griffin, people. I was like, yeah.
What?
And then I was also like,
you
Patty Griffin
save her.
Is breathing my same air right now. Like, our oxygen is just, like, circulating. Please, please impart your divine songwriting oxygen into me.
I love it.
Shout out to Southwest.
Yeah, exactly.
I love flying Southwest.
Always.
Just saying.
They have some great tips about how not to give up the middle. You know, anyway, you'll have... Everybody will have to go listen to their episode about it.
Yeah,
we talk about it a lot.
We have an episode that has middle seat in the title, and that's the one.
Awesome. Perfect.
And
I'm
free
all over
drink
that.
Tickets. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So good.
Okay, so good. Speaking of your music, though, so what's next in that arena?
Yes.
Yeah, we have a single called Just Kiss
it's
Me.
It's called Just Kiss Me. It's, like, a really fun, like, if you've ever dated someone or, like, been friends with someone, and you're like, okay, we're, like, too close now to just not be, like... Just kiss me. Like, you
love it.
Like, something is happening. Like, let's just.
Yeah.
Not that we've ever had that happen before. Like, ever.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's just a fun, like, poppy, fun song.
Let's play it right now.
Yeah.
You're the 2 a.m. call when I'm up all night. When I don't wanna go out, you're my alibi. It's always one more drink, cause you and I don't wanna go home alone one more time. But you never make a move, what you think you're gonna lose? There's really not much that you have to do. Just kiss me.
Kiss me.
everybody else knows it should be happening. So tell me, do you want? 'Cause you know I'm waiting on you. I'm done being comfy. Just kiss me. How many signs do you need to see? Just kiss me. Not like the world's gonna end if you just lean in. Kiss me. Just kiss me.
To know if somebody is working on, you know, taking the next step in something that scares them, or maybe the first step, or maybe they feel stuck, maybe. Do you have any advice for them? What would you say to them right now?
I think what Kate said earlier, movement begets movement, is like such a big thing.
That's what I my took answer. Yours.
It's like, it's our answer. That's
it's
our
this collective
no,
answer.
No, it's so true.
Our collective it's, answer. Do something. Move yeah. in some way. Go to a different coffee shop. Cut your hair.
I like, can't tell you how many times we will say the words like, I need to take a lap. And that means physically getting, like, Jill's house used to be in this like circular, like you could literally do a lap. And I mean, we were stuck a lot, like majorly stuck. So I can't tell you how many times it was like, we need to take a lap. When you don't feel like doing it, do it anyway. Because also what we've learned since then is that why am I even saying this? You probably know way more about this, but the bilateral movement and processing, that's like when your brain starts working. So like walk, like yeah. if you can't do anything else, if you can't get outside for whatever reason, walk around your living room. Like, move something.
Yeah, it's like physical movement, and then, you know, move something in your life that is just going to throw it a little bit off.
In our book, that's what we really talk about. We really kind of, not like break down in steps, but we really talk about the process. Because so many people want to make this great move or change their life. And in the book, we really try to give some really practical steps of what to do maybe before that, because not everybody's at the place to just like, I'm going to sell everything right now.
Right.
Like, there's generally lead up time. It's not like, oh, we had that idea and the next day we sold everything. It was like, there was a 2 month process, you know?
Yeah. And all that requires movement.
Yes. And how to kind of have the right mindset through it all and just kind of how to prepare for that. That's kind of like what we are talking about in the book too. So yeah.
Move. Awesome.
Move. Love it. Is that the name?
No.
Oh, we don't know yet. Okay.
We have a working title, but yeah. I don't love it, so we're going to try to figure it out.
That's all good. Yeah.
Well, so excited. Yes. Well, we're so excited just to, you know, watch as you guys continue the journey.
And same. Thank you guys.
Like, thank you so much.
It's fun to have people that are kind of doing similar stuff.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely.
Thanks
the quad.
For having us.
The quad life.
We're stronger together. The quad.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Love it. But awesome. Thanks for having us.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you guys so much.
Yes.
Thanks for joining us today. If you like what you heard, please subscribe, share with a friend, and follow us on social media. You can find more info and links in our show notes. And don't forget to check out our new single, Good Man, under the band name Jasper and Jade on Spotify.
So, two. The laughing. That's where we should start, really.
Yes.